Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Sports Psychology for Dummies, Second Edition, by Leif Smith, PsyD, and Todd Kays, PhD, narrated by B.J. Harrison. Publisher's note: this audiobook will refer to visual elements included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Limit of liability, disclaimer of warranty. While the publisher and authors have used their best efforts in preparing this work, they make no representations or warranties with respect to the accuracy or completeness of the contents of this work, and specifically disclaim all warranties, including, without limitation, any implied warranties of merchantability or fitness for a particular purpose. No warranty may be created or extended by sales representatives, written sales materials, or promotional statements for this work. The fact that an organization, website, or product is referred to in this work as a citation and/or potential source of further information does not mean that the publisher and authors endorse the information or services the organization, website, or product may provide, or recommendations it may make. This work is sold with the understanding that the publisher is not engaged in rendering professional services. The advice and strategies contained herein may not be suitable for your situation. You should consult with a specialist where appropriate. Further, readers should be aware that websites listed in this work may have changed or disappeared between when this work was written and when it is read. Neither the publisher nor authors shall be liable for any loss of profit or any other commercial damages, including but not limited to special, incidental, consequential, or other damages. Introduction. Sports psychology is a relatively new field, but it's one of the fastest-growing areas in sports performance. Professional sports are big money, and teams want a return on their investment in their players. So it should come as no surprise that every NFL, NBA, MLB, and NHL team employs someone trained in sports psychology to assist them with helping players work through mental blocks, slumps, anxiety and depression issues, and general decreases in performance. We wrote this book because we want to share the information that we teach to elite athletes and teams with the general public. Sports psychologists can be expensive, and most athletes who are just looking for a way to get the edge in their sports participation can't afford to fork over thousands of dollars. With this book, you don't have to. You hold in your hands the same information we share with our clients for a tiny fraction of the cost. In the past 10 years, we have seen the greatest demand for our services from the middle school and high school student-athlete populations. This is great news, because it means that parents understand how important the mental side of sports is. And you can learn from this book many of the mental skills used by some of the best athletes in the world. This book is packed full of information that can help athletes get more out of their physical talent. We've filled this book with techniques and skills that we teach to professional and Olympic athletes. Skills that you can apply in your own training immediately, starting today. About this book. Most sports psychology books provide good stories and education on sports psychology concepts, but they don't take the next step and cover actual techniques and strategies that athletes can use. In this book, we do exactly that. Plus, this book is organized for busy athletes who are on the go and don't have a lot of time to waste. The information is easy to access and written in plain English, without any psychobabble to bog you down. All you need is a thirst for knowledge and a willingness to work hard to reach your goals. We bring the rest. We don't use many special conventions in this book, but there are a few you should be aware of. When we want to share a story from our practice as sports psychologists, we refer to ourselves by our first names, so you can tell which of us is telling you the story. For example, we may say, Leif was working with a professional hockey team, or Todd's client was a young tennis phenom. When you hear the names Leif and Todd, just remember, that's us. Whenever we define a new term, we put emphasis on it and define it shortly thereafter. To make the content more accessible, we divided it into 5 parts. Part 1. Getting the Winning Edge, Sports Psychology Fundamentals. This part introduces the basic concepts of sports psychology. We start by telling you how to build your mental toughness, an essential skill for any competitive athlete. Then, goal setting, because you're more likely to get somewhere you want to be if you know where you're going. We show you how to monitor your motivation and boost it when you need to. Finally, we give you the information you need to increase your confidence, because without confidence in your own skills and abilities, it doesn't matter how talented you are or how hard you've worked. Part 2. Your Mental Toolkit for Success. In this part, we dig into some key concepts that you need to know in your pursuit of competitive greatness. This part is basically the applied mental drills that you can use in your everyday life, including focus, imagery, routines, being mindful, and dealing with pressure. Part 3. Hot Topics in Sports Psychology. This part begins by exploring common mental health issues everyone, including athletes, are facing in today's fast-paced and pressure-filled world. It covers what high school athletes need to know about the college recruiting process. It also explores the path to becoming a sports psychologist, as well as how to use mental tools in everyday life. Part 4. The Sports Psychology Savvy Coach. This part is for all coaches, including how they can use sports psychology drills and concepts in practices and competitions. Coaches can help their players and team be more successful through this applied section on sports psychology. If you are a coach, this section is written specifically for you. Part 5, the Part of Tens. This part explains how you can apply sports psychology principles and concepts to become a better competitor, no matter the sport. It also discusses how parents can become better at parenting young athletes. The book ends with a chapter on how you can become a better leader as an athlete and lead your team and fellow athletes to victory. Foolish Assumptions. In writing this book, we made some assumptions about you. One or more of the following should apply to you. You're an athlete with particular goals that you'd like to achieve, and you think that the mental aspect of your training and performance can benefit from further understanding and practice. You're willing to work hard to achieve your goals. You're a coach, and you want to use sports psychology to help your athletes achieve their goals. You recognize that training isn't just physical. You're a parent of an athlete, and you want to support your kid's athletic career in all the right ways. Chapter 17 covers all you need to know if you're considering a career in sports psychology. So if that describes you, we've got you covered as well. Icons used in this book. Like all For Dummies books, this book's margins are sprinkled with icons to help direct your attention to certain topics, definitions, and interesting information. In this audio edition, these icons will be verbalized. Here's a key to what they mean. Tip: this icon directs you to techniques that world-class athletes use to improve their performance. Remember, this book is a reference book, which means you don't have to commit it to memory. You can come back to it when you need it. But when you hear this icon, you're sure to find information that we think is so crucial that you need to remember it. Anecdote: this icon alerts you to stories or examples of some of our work with athletes from all walks of life. Technical stuff: this icon is for people who can't get enough of sports psychology principles. You can skip reading these paragraphs without consequence. But if you really want the inside scoop, read on. Warning: when you hear this icon, you can be sure we're alerting you to a danger or pitfall of some sort, something you should avoid. Beyond the book: in addition to what you're reading right now, this product also comes with a free access anywhere cheat sheet that includes tips on creating your project schedule, shortcut keys, and helpful websites to hone your experience. To get this cheat sheet, simply go to dummies.com and type Sports Psychology for Dummies cheat sheet in the search box. Where to go from here? This book isn't linear. You don't have to read it from beginning to end, like a novel. Each chapter is self-contained, so you can start anywhere you want and skip around as you like. Here are a few suggestions for places to begin. If you're new to sports psychology, you've only heard about it, but you've never practiced any sports psychology techniques, start with part one for a good foundation. If you want to improve in a specific area, like focus or managing pressure, it's covered in part two, where we discuss many mental tools that we have used in our work with athletes over the past 20-plus years. If you want to learn about the current trends and hot topics in sports psychology, then make part three your destination. If you're looking for ways to improve your team's performance, part four is for you. And if you're a parent or coach who wants to use sports psychology to help athletes in your life, or you want to become a better leader on your team, head to part five. We hope you enjoy using this book to help you accomplish your goals. We also hope you share with us your success stories and accomplishments, and what you found helpful in this book. Feel free to email us directly at drsmith@personalbestconsulting.com and drkays@athleticmindinstitute.com. You can also find us on YouTube, Instagram, and Twitter. Just search for our names and stay connected to keep learning how to use the concepts we teach in this book. Part 1: Getting the Winning Edge, Sports Psychology Fundamentals. In this part, get to know what sports psychology is and its overall application. Learn what your ideal mental profile is for maximum performance. Know and begin to apply the basics of effective goal setting. Understand motivation in sports and learn how to maximize your own. Learn what confidence really is and ways to build your swagger. Chapter 1: Introducing Sports Psychology and Mental Training. In this chapter, knowing what sports psychology can do for you. Seeing your mind as a tool for success. Using sports psychology to prepare for competition. Understanding the hottest trends in sports psychology. Drawing on sports psychology tools as a coach. You've probably heard of elite athletes working with sports psychologists, and pro teams having sports psychologists on staff. But what exactly is sports psychology, and is it limited to the pros? Sports psychology is simply the practical application of psychological principles in a sports setting. It's used to help an athlete or team improve their performance. And it absolutely isn't limited to professional athletes. In fact, we're seeing sports psychology used at all levels of sport. The field of sports psychology provides benefits and knowledge to youth, high school, and college athletes, as well as to coaches, parents, administrators, sports medicine physicians, strength and conditioning coaches, dietitians, and physical therapists. It's used in the more popular sports, such as soccer, football, golf, and tennis, as well as in lesser-known ones, such as judo, snowboarding, fencing, and cricket. Sports psychology is even being used and applied in the non-sport realms, including medicine, education, business, politics, organizational development, and the military. Its benefits and uses are growing by leaps and bounds throughout the world. It's an exciting time to be tapping into the benefits of sports psychology. The good news is that you don't have to pay hundreds or thousands of dollars to hire your own personal sports psychologist. With this book in your hands, you have an edge over other athletes, and most important, the ability to reach your highest potential. Honing your sharpest weapon, your mind. The greatest tool that any athlete has is the mind. The brain, that wonderful organ that regulates your breathing, controls your beating heart, and manages the rest of your body, is at the core of all successful sports performances. Everybody knows that talent and physical skill play an enormous role in every athlete's success. But not many people understand the importance of the mind and how we use it. In fact, your mind is one of the most powerful pieces of sports equipment you'll ever own. It can make or break you. By understanding the power of your mind and being able to use it to your advantage, you can improve your performance. Sports psychology can help you to manage performance anxiety, use visualization and imagery to improve your performance, increase and maintain your confidence, improve and maintain your level of motivation, relax under pressure, set and achieve goals, manage your energy levels, use routines to be consistent in your performance, bounce back from injuries and setbacks, manage and address conflicts with coaches and teammates, focus in critical moments and extend the duration of your concentration, manage stress and other mental health issues, better communicate with others, know yourself better. Knowing how your mind influences your sports performance. Your mind, which is the end product of all the wonderful thinking processes that occur in your physical brain, has a powerful impact on your sports performance. In fact, it has been having that powerful impact previously, even if you weren't aware of it. Have you ever felt fear before a match, competition, or game? That's your mind at work. Have you ever performed well, but unexpectedly? That was your mind at work also. Finally, have you ever achieved an important goal in your sport, even though it took a long time and a lot of hard work along the way? Once again, that came from the efforts of your mind. Our mind influences our performance, both in and out of sport. And this book helps you understand how to affect changes in your mind that will produce amazing results in your performance. From setting goals, Chapter 3, to building motivation and confidence, Chapters 4 and 5, to using powerful tools and techniques that professionals use, Chapters 6 through 12, you learn how to direct your mind to govern your body, heart, and attitude, all to produce the results you want in sports competition. Discovering your ideal mindset in sports performance. What is the ideal mindset for maximum performance in sport? Is there one? We, Leif and Todd, are asked this question all the time. Although performance is a combination of talent, circumstances, and effort, performing at your best can indeed become a habit. When you learn the ideal mindset for performing at your best, you can replicate it over and over again. Chapters 9 and 10 can help you get a jump start on your competition and start developing your ideal mindset. Building your ideal mindset with awareness and the right processes. Building this ideal mindset, much like making any change in your life, starts with awareness. You need to be aware first of the mindset that has been holding you back in competition. You also, most importantly, need to be aware of the mindset you possess when you are performing at your best. We are taught to focus on the negative and be self-critical, but we need to spend more time and energy on what we are doing right. Having a good supporting cast of family, friends, coaches, and teammates around you helps you do this. And from there, you can begin to take the tools that you learn in this book to build a better mindset, step by step. This is the essence, the process, by which you can begin to perform better, at higher levels, and more consistently. For more information on ways to start developing this process, it's covered in chapters 2 and 8. Understanding your motivation. Motivation can come from within, we call this intrinsic motivation, and it can come from things outside of yourself, such as money, fame, or status. We call this type of motivation extrinsic motivation. When you understand how to utilize both types of motivation to your advantage, you hasten your development as a complete athlete, combining mind and body together to maximize the talent you already have for your sport. Chapter 4 is a powerful chapter, and it gives you the tools you need to understand and improve your motivation in sports. Understanding and building confidence for your athletic performance. One of the wonderful aspects of sports psychology principles and techniques is that they're applicable on and off the field. They help you improve your confidence. And all improved performances, on and off the field, result from a gradual improvement in your confidence. The more confident you are, the more risks you take, and the more rewards and positive consequences you experience. All successful athletes know that when they're confident and comfortable, their chances for success are dramatically higher, even though their preparation and physical fitness may be the same. Confidence frees you to perform, compete, and reach your highest potential. And confidence is not an all-or-nothing game. It changes and develops over time. We want you to be in a place where you fear less and dream and create more. When you build confidence, you can try new things without fearing how you will look in front of others or worrying what they will think of you. In Chapter 5, we show you the art and the science of building true confidence. We like to call this swagger. We help you take the guesswork out of the process of improving your self-confidence and give you a solid framework from which to improve your performance in sports. We also show you how best to address and manage those times when your confidence drops. Your goal should be to maximize the times when your confidence is high and minimize the times when it's not. This is one of the secrets of confidence in sports. Building, preparing, and practicing your mental toolkit. In developing your mind through sports psychology training, you want to develop your own personal mental toolkit that contains the techniques and strategies you need to strengthen your mental muscle. Just as you can use equipment to help you improve your physical fitness, there are tools you can use to do the same for your mind. Focus is one of the most critical mental skills to develop for success in athletics. It's one of the most common assets of successful athletes, and a lack of focus is a primary reason for mental errors, mistakes, and the inability to perform under pressure. In Chapter 6, we give you Tool Number 1, Mastering the Art of Focus, so that you can take your focus up a notch. Mental imagery can help you build confidence, manage pressure, recover from mistakes and poor performance, and prepare for practice and competition. In Chapter 7, we offer you Tool Number 2, Seeing is Believing, and we explain what imagery is and how it works, giving you specific steps to use the tool of imagery in your sport. As an athlete, you're constantly working toward specific goals, and you are creating habits that will propel you toward victory. In Chapter 9, we introduce you to Tool Number 4, Winning Habits, and help you understand and harness the power of routines in your sport so that you can become more consistent in both your preparation and your results. Seeing Sports Psychology in Action. As you use your mental tools, covered in the preceding section, you'll see the direct benefits of sports psychology in action, in practice and in competition. As you practice and compete, you face all kinds of pressure. Being a great athlete is about being able to perform your best when the pressure is on. In Chapter 10, you'll learn about Tool Number 5, Handling Pressure, where we give you specific strategies for improving your ability to do exactly that. And because mistakes are a regular part of the sports world, in Chapter 11, we offer you Tool Number 6, Handling Adversity, and we give you lots of advice for becoming more resilient. From simple mistakes in competition to longer slumps, we show you how to move on from the mistakes of your past and focus on performing your best in the present. As an athlete, you have to manage your energy levels before a competition to harness the mental and physical energy you need when it counts. In Chapter 12, you learn about Tool Number 7, Sharpening Your Awareness. There, we explain how to calm down and pump yourself up so your energy resources are always there for you when you need them. Knowing the hot trends in sports psychology today. Mental health issues are one of the hottest topics discussed in the field of athletics today. Anxiety and depression aren't just battled off the court or field. Athletes have to battle them on the court, too, and we discuss this topic in greater detail in Chapter 13. Remember, managing stress is such an important topic in sports psychology today that we chose to dedicate another chapter to it entirely. After reading Chapter 14, you'll be better prepared to understand the sources of stress in your life and manage them more effectively in the future. We get so many requests from parents and high school athletes to help them navigate the ever-changing recruitment process from high school to college athletics that we devote a whole chapter about it, chapter 15. It is a complicated process, and we believe that this chapter simplifies the process. Ever wonder how the skills in this book can be applied outside of sport? Well, wait no longer, because chapter 16, Using Sports Psychology Skills in Daily Life, is written just for you. Since writing the first edition of this book in 2010, the field of sports psychology has expanded so dramatically in popularity that we get requests on a weekly basis from students interested in the field, asking us for direction and career advice. What a wonderful development. Thus, we dedicated an entire chapter, chapter 17, to exploring the career path of a sports psychologist. If you are a student with interest in this field, this chapter is written with you in mind. Remember, sports psychology is a growing and ever-changing field of study and applied techniques, and this popularity is due in part to how applicable sports psychology is to life outside of sports too. Becoming a Sports Psychology Savvy Coach. Coaches are constantly looking for that extra edge that will put them over the top in the ultra-competitive sports world. With that in mind, they frequently turn to sports psychology to learn better ways to understand their players, motivate their teams, and get more from the talent they have at their disposal. Every day, coaches see athletes with incredible talent who can perform in practice, but who can't carry that performance into competition. They know and understand that the mindset of their athletes is often what determines their success. If you're a coach, you'll find plenty of advice throughout this book that you can use to help your athletes be their best. But we devote chapters 18 and 19 in particular to you. There, you find strategies for helping your athletes improve their focus and perform under pressure, as well as mental drills you can utilize with your team to enhance and improve their mental development alongside their physical development. Remember, don't limit yourself to chapters 18 and 19 if you're a coach. The advice we give to athletes throughout this book is information you can share with your players individually or as a team to help them reach their potential. Chapter 2. Starting with the end in mind. Know your ideal athlete mindset. In this chapter, determining your ideal mindset. Using journaling to hone your mindset. Assessing and improving your mindset. Getting into the zone. Knowing your ideal mental state is a critical step in building your mind for consistent, high-level performance. Most people habitually criticize themselves for even the smallest of mistakes. It becomes a bad habit that they don't know how to break. When asking athletes, performers, and everyday people about their past negative experiences and mistakes, they can usually quickly recall a long list of them. These are the experiences and incidents that stand out in our brains. Our default mental state, unfortunately, is usually negative. It is an almost automatic response. As a culture, we are trained to focus on the negatives in our everyday lives. There is an evolutionary and biological reason for this fact as well, such as fear kept people alive thousands of years ago, because without focusing on the possibility of danger around them, they could have easily been attacked by a hungry animal. Think about it for yourself. Do you focus on the positive things you are doing in terms of your performance? Or do you focus on the negative? What are your thoughts about this response from one of our professional athletes who had just made the World Cup soccer team? I cannot believe I had such an awful practice today. Why did they even keep me on the national team? He did not even take a few seconds to celebrate his accomplishment of making the World Cup soccer team for his nation. Clearly, the battle to stay positive in our brains is a very real one. Anecdote. Here's another example from a high school softball player we were working with. She had gone 1-for-4 at the plate, no errors in the field, and pitched 3 solid innings that game. She did happen to pitch at the time when a tying run scored from the opposite team, however. Her team went on to lose, but she spent almost a week beating herself up for that one pitch, and the pitch was a good one. The hitter was very good. Her inner critic took over for days. She took the loss personally and did not consider that there were 3 fielding errors by her teammates or that her team's batting average at the plate that game was about 200 and the opposing team was highly ranked nationwide. The point we are making here is simply that neither of these athletes took the time to think about, absorb, and celebrate the positive aspects of their performance. This is where having an ideal mindset can help, however. If you do not work on your ideal mindset, you cannot practice it, refine it, or master it. Thus, if you infrequently pay attention to when you perform well and frequently obsess when you do not, usually due to a mistake or two, your default negative mindset will continue. And this is not helpful for performing at your best. Tapping into your ideal mindset. The first step is building awareness of what your ideal mindset can be. A good place to start is to make a list of some of your best performances. Speak with your coach, who can help you come up with some of these. Ask your friends, a teammate, or a parent or family member. As you discuss these performances, write them down in a performance journal or verbalize them in a voice notes app on your cell phone. Use the following questions to help jog your brain. How were you behaving? Smiling, laughing, cheering on teammates, communicating, bouncing back after a mistake? What were you thinking about? Maybe nothing? Something simple like this play or breathe, or be here now. What did you experience emotionally? Calmness, focus, excitement, lightness, ease, confidence? What did you notice about your body? Were your muscles tense, loose? Was your heart rate fast or slow or moderate? Was your breathing quick and shallow or deep, slow, and comfortable? Once you learn more about your ideal mindset by logging your past great performances, you can begin to practice re-experiencing this mindset over and over again with the other tools included in this book. However, if you do not cultivate this mindset ahead of time, you will be simply trying to find the door in a completely dark room. Anecdote. Todd frequently uses the following analogy with his athletes and performers. He tells them that he wants to meet at Starbucks for their next meeting. Since there are probably about 50 of these stores within a 20-mile radius in Columbus, it could be any of a number of locations. So what are they going to do? Drive to each coffee place and see if he is there? Call each store and ask if there is a good-looking sports psychologist in the store? Or Todd can just tell them the exact location. That way, they do not have to guess. They may know where it is already, or simply plug it into their GPS. In the same way, if you know your ideal mindset for great performance, you can practice it right away. Or you can just let your mind continue to criticize you and run on its default setting. The choice is yours. Discovering your ideal performance mindset. Here are some steps you can take to start learning what your ideal performance mindset is and to utilize it every time you compete. Start with questions you want to address about past great performances, yesterday or last year, in practice or in competition. And then consider the following advice. Describe the time and place you were competing. Remember it as vividly as possible, as if you were there, competing right now. Describe what made this one of your best performances. Remember that you may not have won the game, or the ideal mindset may have only been present for a small time during your game or competition. Some examples might be batting 4-for-4 at the plate, scoring a career high in points, shooting your lowest score in golf, or beating a top-ranked opponent. Just as you did previously, answer these prompts. Behaviors. Were you smiling, laughing, cheering on teammates, communicating, or bouncing back after a mistake? Thoughts. What were you thinking about? Maybe nothing? Something simple like this play, or breathe, or be here now. Emotions. What did you experience emotionally? Calm? Excitement? Lightness? Ease? Confidence? Body. What did you notice about your body? Were your muscles tense or loose? Was your heart rate fast or slow or moderate? Was your breathing short and shallow, or easy, deep, and comfortable? Identify important information by writing in your journal. Remember, every athlete should have a performance journal. Those who use a journal effectively and consistently get better quicker. It can be a small journal that you can keep in your athletic bag. Just make it a durable one, as we all know how we toss around our athletic bags. This journal should go with you everywhere. Journal continuously and consistently each time you have a great performance. You want to key in with specifics and be clear about what exactly was happening during your performance. Spend time visualizing and burning these performance details into your brain. Read Chapter 7 on imagery to learn more about how to do this like the pros. Continue to reread some of your entries in this journal as a mental training drill from time to time. Remember, if you do not practice your physical skills, for example, your tennis forehand or your free throws, you won't improve. By the same token, how can you get better at building your ideal mindset if you don't practice and perform this simple drill? Journaling doesn't need to take a long time. Maybe at times you will decide to enjoy reliving the experience, and it will be an incredible and long journal entry that you may refer back to for years. But it also can be a simple jotting down of notes or bullet points after a performance. Just remember, the quality of a practice does make a difference, as you know, and therefore, so does the quality of journaling and mental training. Think about if a field kicker spent their practice time using only about 50% of their focus. How would you predict that to work out? Try to journal as soon after the experience as you can, while the memory is fresh in your brain. You can do this before you leave the locker room or field, or you can journal while on the bus or car ride home. The sooner you do so, the better the details and exact recall of your performance. Performing without thinking. Personal best performances typically do not involve much thinking, only great physical and mental preparation. An important awareness point here is that many times when we perform our best, we are not thinking, at least consciously anyway. Anecdote. When asked by a reporter about his mental training, one of our professional athletes said, "There are moments I train for all year. I know these moments do not necessarily happen as much as I would like, but I could do anything with the puck tonight. I knew exactly where to pass, and there was no stopping me on the offensive side. I knew it was going to be a multiple-goal game. It just happened. I was not thinking about anything. I did all the prep work, mind, body, and skill, with Doc, and it just happened sometimes." Another response on mindset from one of our golfers. "I was 30 yards out, had for some reason practiced it during the week, imagined in my mind and heart hundreds of times that this type of shot was going to happen. It just did. I knew it was going in after I hit it." Remember, in working with thousands of athletes and performers from all over the world, it is obvious to us that one of our goals is to help them not think during performances. We can't emphasize this point strongly enough. Mental training is about using your mind to get your body to follow. Developing a plan of attack to make it consistent. If you want to consistently hit more serves or obtain a higher free throw percentage, you need to practice first serves or free throws. Your mindset is no different. This book is all about providing ways for you to practice your mindset in that same manner. After all, perfect practice makes perfect, right? So how should you practice this? Consider these tips. Be consistent with your journal. Journaling about your top performances once per month is not going to help you improve, just as decreasing your 100 backstroke time won't happen if you practice it only once a month. Aim to journal about your best performances or top performance moments 4 to 5 times per week. If you state that you are going to journal every single practice or every single day and miss one, don't beat yourself up and then give up. Expect that, on occasion, you will miss a time or two. That's okay. Keep going. Take 5 to 10 minutes before practice to read a journal entry or two about your top performances. This process triggers those good memories in your mind and helps you connect with what it is to be in your ideal mental and emotional state right before practice. You then increase your chances of having a better practice. What do you think that will do to your confidence? If you have an extended break in action during a practice, game, or workout, take a quick glance at your journal again. It is hard for all of us to stay focused for long periods of time, so good mental preparation can simply take the form of reminding ourselves what we want and need to be our best. After a game or competition, think about your great performance moments. Jot down the important details. Remember, it does not have to be an entire game or competition. It might be one wrestling move, such as a first period double leg takedown that you hit. But those moments are the critical ones to focus on. Spend 5 to 10 minutes, 3 to 4 times per week, and reimagine those moments. Covered in Chapter 7 on Imagery. When you bring these images to your conscious mind and re-experience them in your body, you are training your body to become more familiar and more comfortable with this state of mind or being. Consider these additional ways to track and keep connected to these great mindset moments. Use voice notes on a computer or phone and simply describe in your own words what it was like. Listen to podcasts from great athletes about what it is like for them when they have those incredible moments. Listen to podcasts associated with this book about how to practice and learn your ideal zone of performance. Learning and improvement never stops. Discuss these great moments with teammates, coaches, parents, and friends. Every time you do so, your heart and body connect to this mindset, and it becomes more familiar. This is when your ideal mindset starts to happen more consistently. Preparing your ideal mindset. There is a difference between preparation and practice. In this case, your preparation is going to be learning and developing your awareness of your ideal mindset. You can do this using all of the different ways mentioned in this chapter. Practicing your mindset. When you practice your mindset, you have already prepared your mind to understand what your ideal mindset is. Then, you can use the steps mentioned in the chapter to develop your own practice routines. These routines should incorporate steps in your training and practice schedule. Also, feel free to create your own individual style of doing things. Be curious, be creative, no judgment. Reread this chapter as a refresher every few months. The key is to making practicing your ideal mindset as common and normal as practicing your sports skills. However works best for you, do it. Assessing and improving your mindset. This practice drill can easily be done when you are journaling, listening to a podcast on mindset, reading this or another book on mental training, or talking with a mental performance consultant or psychologist. Every time you do these drills, you are bringing to mind the importance of mindset development. The more you can do this, the more these skills can help you become aware of what you are doing well and what still needs improvement. Remember, it is important to focus on what you are doing well. And this mindset doesn't come naturally to humans. Remember how the brain has a negative, fear-based default setting? Practice making your ideal mindset your competitive mindset. Ask others around you what they see in your mental performance. You will be pleasantly surprised about what they will notice and tell you, and you can use those insights next time you practice crafting your ideal mindset. Avoiding the mindset of perfection. If you want to improve your mindset, you also need to work on accepting yourself as human and imperfect. In sports, athletes seem determined to pursue perfection at all costs. They talk and think about it so much that they actually start to believe that it exists. Here is an inevitable truth, however. Perfection has not, does not, and will not ever exist for you or for others. You have high moments of excellence, but truly, there is no perfection. So why keep pursuing it? Tip. Rather than striving for perfection, what about the idea of pursuing better? Better performances, better mindset, better practice, better technique. The idea of better is much more achievable, measurable, and doable than perfection. In sports and in life, better equates to improved performances. It also leaves room for those moments when you aren't performing at your best. In other words, it has all the upside and very little downside. So instead of pursuing perfection as your ideal mindset, we encourage you to pursue better. You'll see tremendous long-term results via this shift in thinking. When you can accept that you are perfectly imperfect, you will not get down on yourself so much when you make a mistake or do not perform as you hoped. One of the greatest lessons that anyone can take from this book is the fact that we are all perfectly imperfect as coaches and athletes and human beings. We were designed to be different and to perform differently. In fact, your long-term motivation will endure when you accept this fact and are not constantly criticizing yourself. Slipping into the flow state or zone. Many athletes and people ask us how they can get into the zone, or flow state, where most of the top performances occur. This is when athletes seem to perform without thinking. You might see athletes appear to be in the zone when you watch them on ESPN, or maybe even at a local high school game. Yes, it is possible for everyone and anyone to be in the zone, and not just in athletics. You can be in the zone when it comes to playing music, doing a presentation, being at a job interview, or simply having a wonderful session with an athlete. The fact of the matter is that we do not consciously find the zone, even though we all know what it is. Think about a time when you performed out of your mind. Typically, some words to describe it include feeling like you were in slow motion, or that time stopped, and that you knew things were coming together. We have all been there, albeit not as often as we would like. Remember, the reality is that most athletes accidentally slip into the zone. If you think about the zone as a subconscious state, or a state where no conscious thoughts are occurring, then your body is simply doing what you have trained it to do. The zone isn't your ideal performance mindset. It is the result of you training and developing your ideal performance mindset. When you practice these mental skills consistently, you learn to develop your ideal performance mindset much more consistently. And when this happens, your odds of slipping into the zone or flow state of mind increase dramatically. Chapter 3. Setting goals. Aiming high and hitting the bullseye. In this chapter, setting effective goals, establishing deadlines for each goal, keeping track of your progress. Most people miss the mark when it comes to goal setting, whether in sports or in life. The good news is, with this book in your hands, you won't be one of those people. So, why do most people fail at goal setting? Because they were never taught the simple secrets that comprise the art of making your dreams a reality, which is really all that goal setting is. In this chapter, we introduce you to this art. We share with you the same information we've shared with thousands of other athletes who have come to us to work on setting and achieving goals. When you set goals correctly, your goals will allow you to achieve results that you never thought possible. Remember, goal setting and motivation, two peas in a pod. Motivation is the fuel that powers your goals toward becoming a reality. If you're not motivated and inspired by your goals, you won't achieve them. And if you don't have goals, you won't be motivated to improve. A simple way to measure your level of motivation is to use what we call the get-out-of-bed test. Do your goals make you want to get out of bed and hurry toward their achievement? Do they keep you up at night, excited, unable to sleep, because you're too busy pursuing them? If so, your level of motivation is strong. If not, then you need to set better, more inspiring goals. This does not mean you will always feel great about getting out of bed, for we are human, and sometimes our motivation ebbs and flows, but it should be there most of the time if you are seeking important goals and doing the goal-setting process in the correct manner. Many athletes tell us that at times they lose their motivation to compete in their sports. They complain that it's no longer fun, that their coaches' demands annoy them, that their passion for training isn't what it used to be. When we ask these athletes what their current goals are, they usually say, "I don't know. I haven't thought about it." They're focused on the misery and pain and complaining. They've lost focus on their goals and the reasons they compete, and their motivation has declined because of it. When you get into a car, you usually know your destination. When you start driving toward your destination, you're focused on making sure you reach it, which helps you adjust when you encounter obstacles, such as closed roads, traffic jams and passing trains blocking the intersection. You're committed to reaching your destination, but you more than likely keep a flexible approach to getting there, depending on the circumstances and time of day. The same is true with goal setting in your sport. You need to know where you're headed. Then, after you've set inspiring goals, you need to stay flexible in your approach to making them come true. Obstacles will come in many forms: injuries, coaching decisions, sickness, and other unforeseen training issues. Your job as an athlete is to keep your mind focused on your goals, which, on occasion, requires that you take alternative routes to success. Goal setting is both art and science. The key to good goal setting is outlining goals that inspire and motivate you. They should wake you up early and keep you up late at night. Setting effective goals. Goal setting is really about being able to answer a couple simple questions. Where do you want to go in your sport? What will athletic success look like when you accomplish it? In the following sections, we walk you through setting your long-term and intermediate goals, making sure your goals are specific and challenging, and setting timelines for your goals. Determining your goals. Goals can be divided into the following categories: long-term goals, 1 to 3 years, mid-term goals, 6 months to 1 year, short-term goals, 1 to 6 months, immediate goals, 1 day to 1 week. In order to achieve your goals, each goal should build on the last. In other words, goals should be successive and cumulative. If you want to be an All-American, you have to start by being All-Conference. Before that, you have to get enough playing time to be noticed. Before that, you need to earn a spot on the team. Start with your end in mind when you set about determining your priorities and goals in your pursuit of athletic success. Tip: work with specialized and trusted coaches to provide perspective and education. For example, when it comes to fitness goals, strength and conditioning coaches and exercise specialists are key. A skills coach would be helpful if you're a tennis player wanting to improve the speed of your serve. Work with a sports psychologist to help understand and establish mental and emotional goals. Getting to your long-term goal takes time and expertise. Use your support team to help you. Long-term goals. You need to start by setting your long-term goal. This is the goal that will guide and inspire you to greater heights as an athlete. It's usually set at about 1 to 3 years out. Anything longer than that is unrealistic as a timeline, since things change so rapidly in our current world. Technical stuff. The differences between goals and priorities. What's the difference between a goal and a priority? A goal is an outcome around which you focus your attention. It's the purpose toward which your efforts are directed. A priority, on the other hand, is a goal that is more important to you than other goals. Priorities are simply the goals that are most important to your success. All goals are important, but as an athlete, you need to set priorities to help shape your destiny. Which goals you've prioritized as most important will determine the magnitude of your success in your sport. Choose your priorities wisely. They're critical to your success. It is important to remember that sometimes your priorities will involve setting certain goals in specific aspects of your sport development, such as a certain skill, a fitness area such as speed, or a mental area such as learning to manage pressure and maintain poise more effectively. Tip: for most athletes, professional and Olympic athletes use different timelines. 1 year or one season is the perfect timetable for long-term goals. Anything longer, and you risk losing focus and motivation. Here are some examples of long-term goals. Be the starting goalie on the team. Improve my national recognition among college coaches. Become all-conference. Be one of the mentally toughest players in the state. Remember, dream big. Make your goals big. Search within yourself for what you want to happen in 1 year. Don't place limits on yourself. Sure, you should be realistic. You aren't going to get a college scholarship if you decide to play football your senior year and you haven't played since the fourth grade. But too many people place limits on themselves before they even begin the goal-setting process. Limiting ourselves is probably one of the greatest human challenges we all make at times. And connected to this challenge is one of the greatest emotions that gets in the way: fear. Midterm goals. Next, set approximately 3 midterm goals that you intend to achieve in about 6 months or half a season. These goals should be what we like to call process goals, or goals that deal with how you plan on going about doing things. For example, if your long-term goal is to become an all-conference athlete, your midterm process goals might include the following. Out-hustle every person on the field. Be the best-conditioned athlete on the field. Become more offensive-minded. Immediately let go of mistakes and recover from poor performance. Technical stuff. There is a difference between outcome goals and process goals. Outcome goals are what you're pursuing, and process goals are how you're pursuing it. Outcome goals are usually not within your control, but they help guide you to greater heights in sports and are many times the fuel and motivation for you. The process goals are completely in your control and help increase the probability that you'll reach your outcome goals. Short-term goals. Your short-term goals are ones that take 1 to 6 months and directly feed into your midterm goals. The accomplishment of the short-term goals is necessary for the success of the midterm goals. For example, if your midterm goal is to be the best-conditioned athlete on the field, you could set the following short-term goals. Run 2 miles in 12 minutes. Run the 40-yard dash in less than 5 seconds. Improve my leg strength. Practice my post-mistake mental toughness routine every day in training. These are sometimes called performance goals, where you attach actual statistics to the goal, such as running the 40-yard dash in under 5 seconds. Immediate goals. After you've set your short-term goals, your immediate goals take over. Immediate goals are actions you engage in to better the chances of your short-term goals happening. So if you take the short-term goal of running 2 miles in 12 minutes, the following are examples of immediate goals. Meet with my strength and conditioning coach once a week. Time my 2-mile run at the end of every week. Perform a tempo run, set up by the trainer, 4 days a week. Do cross-training 4 days a week. Make your goals specific. When you walk into a grocery store, whether you've written down a list of items to buy or you have that list in your mind, it's specific. It says more than just food. You know you need milk, bread, cereal, bananas, and so on. If you do show up at the store without a list, you're likely to get home from the store, walk in the door, and realize you forgot something you needed. The same is true for your goals in sports. The more specific you can be when you set your goals, the better your chances of achieving them. Clear and specific goals allow you to have laser-like focus in your pursuit of greatness. They leave little to chance or imagination, allowing you to channel your energy accordingly. Here are some examples of specific and non-specific goals. Non-specific goals: get fit, serve well, play hard, let go of my mistakes. Specific goals: run 2 miles in 12 minutes, have a first service percentage of 60%, make 3 tackles per game, follow my post-mistake routine in games. When you say that you want to play hard, what exactly does that mean? How are you going to measure it? Playing hard could be turned into a specific goal, but as it stands, it's broad, ambiguous, and lacking in clear direction. Remember, specific goals are better because they increase your motivation and focus. You know exactly what you're going after. You know what you're working toward, and your mind will have an easier time staying tuned into that. It is also important to set these goals before practice, optimally a week before. Then you know what you are going to do exactly. If you do not know your goals for practice, it is easy to become unfocused and underperform. Setting goals that challenge you. In addition to being specific, your goals need to be challenging. They should push you beyond your comfort level and be slightly out of your reach. Setting your goals slightly out of reach or slightly higher than you originally plan ensures that you'll be motivated to chase them and improve along the way. If you set goals that are too easy, you'll become bored, you'll lose motivation, and you won't improve. You may feel good for a while. Wow, I'm good. I'm accomplishing so many things. But this feeling won't last. Have you ever noticed how much better you play when you play against athletes who are better than you? Yes, it's difficult, and your ego may take a bruising, but look how much you improve. Warning. At the same time, just make sure you aren't setting unrealistic goals. A goal to become a state champion or make the national team may be challenging and realistic for some, but it may not be realistic for you where you are now. If you set this goal and expect it too soon, you may end up feeling frustrated and losing motivation. You're getting better, maybe much better, but you won't see it because you're focused on a goal that's beyond your reach. Remember, you want to set goals that are challenging enough to motivate you, but not so unrealistic that they discourage you. For example, we both challenge each athlete we work with to set goals slightly above what they think they can achieve. This goes back to the courage to aim high and dream big. Instead of just making the lineup, aim to be a starter. Instead of performing well, work to become all-conference. Higher goals build confidence, and they also push you to think and dream bigger in your pursuit of becoming a better athlete. Setting deadlines for each goal. When you've set goals that are specific and challenging, you'll want to add timelines to each goal. Doing so takes your goals from theory to actual practice. In other words, setting deadlines makes your goals more likely to become reality. Setting deadlines helps you remain focused on your goals so that they don't exist simply as dreams. They become real. Examples include an athlete wanting to be able to leg press a certain amount of weight in 30 days, or a tennis player wanting to hit 200 first serves with at least 50% accuracy going in within 2 weeks. Tip: setting deadlines for your goals is one of the key factors that separates good athletes from elite ones. If you don't set deadlines, you'll likely allow other things to get in the way. Before you know it, the day, week, month, or even year has gone by, and the goal is still sitting there unaccomplished. tip. Put your deadlines for accomplishing your goals on a calendar and review that calendar regularly. You should know every day what you're doing to reach your immediate, short-term, mid-term, and long-term goals. Working with tiny goals. Tiny goals are goals that are smaller in scale and easier to achieve. They are an important part of the goal-setting process because they help build momentum and confidence along the way to those bigger goals that you are hoping to achieve. For instance, if your ultimate goal is to make the varsity high school soccer team, that goal should be made up of much smaller or tiny goals. Have coach learn your name. Get to know the other kids on the team. Practice juggling every day for 5 minutes. Eat a much more nutritious breakfast every day. Get to bed before midnight daily. Stretch more often. Drink more water. Buy a new soccer ball. Watch a motivational sports movie like Rocky. These tiny goals are deceptive in nature, since they initially appear to be too simple and too easy to achieve. However, therein lies the rub, so to speak. The fact that these goals are non-threatening to your brain. Remember, our brains are wired to avoid things that appear to be painful, means that you will be more likely to pursue them. When you are more likely to engage in them, you will be more likely to achieve them. And when you achieve these tiny goals, your confidence will rise. Tiny goals are an underestimated method for getting and keeping momentum in your goal-setting plan for this very reason. Small boosts of confidence along the path to your bigger goals improve the odds that you will be successful. Remember, setting small, easily achievable goals allows you to create momentum that you can use to increase your motivation along the way to your bigger goals. Tracking your success in reaching your goals. Make sure that you're tracking your success in reaching your athletic goals as you go. That way, instead of wondering how you became successful, you'll have a good idea of which strategies worked and which strategies didn't work. You'll know what you did well and what was effective. And you'll know what you didn't do well and which tactics were ineffective. You must keep track of your athletic skills, your fitness levels, and physical strengths and weaknesses, and your mental toughness and abilities. If you don't track these, how will you know that you've reached your goal, or that you're even heading in the right direction? What if you need to make adjustments along the way? If you don't follow and track your success, you'll never know. In this section, we show you how to hold yourself accountable to your goals and measure your progress. We also introduce the concept of adjusting your goals and let you know that doing so is perfectly acceptable. Holding yourself accountable. One of the defining characteristics of great athletes is the ability to hold themselves accountable for their own goals and progress, instead of requiring another teammate, athlete, or coach to hold them accountable. The best athletes place the responsibility for their goals, training, and results directly on their own shoulders. As an athlete, you want to do the same thing. Holding yourself accountable is key. Measuring your progress, covered in the following section, is one way to do that. You can also hold yourself accountable by making goals, expectations, and action plans known to other people you trust, like your coaches, parents, or close teammates, your support network. Then, they can help hold you accountable by inquiring about your progress. For more on support networks, it's covered in Enlisting a Support Network. Celebrating your achievements. It is so important that you celebrate the achievement of your goals, no matter how small or tiny. The author of Tiny Habits, B.J. Fogg, discusses how he celebrated flossing one tooth when he was having a difficult time with motivation. he literally described how he danced and sang when he accomplished this very tiny goal. We are taught to criticize ourselves harshly when we do not reach our goals, and that is not helpful. What is extremely beneficial, however, is creating the habit of celebrating small and tiny successes. It creates such powerfully positive and motivating mindsets. Remember, enlisting a support network. A good support network is worth its weight in gold. A support network ensures accountability, keeps your ego in check, surrounds you with friends when things aren't going your way, allows you to access diverse opinions. Make sure that you build a support network to help you along the path of achieving your goals. Your support network should include a diverse group of 4 or 5 people and could be made up of friends, family, current and former coaches, partners or spouses, medical doctors, chiropractors, nutritionists, sports psychologists, or teachers. The key is to enlist people whose values are similar to yours and whose support you'll need along the way. Be sure to include at least one person who's comfortable being controversial and contrary. You need someone who can tell you no from time to time. No one accomplishes their goals and reaches high levels of success on their own. Measuring your goals. How will you know when you've achieved your goals? That may seem like a simple question, but it isn't always. Goals need to be measurable. For example, you can easily measure a goal such as, "I want to lead the team in tackles this season." But it's more difficult to measure a goal such as, "I want to improve my confidence." For every goal you set, you need a method of measurement. That way, when someone asks you whether you've achieved your goal for the season, or better yet, when you ask yourself whether you've achieved your goal, you'll be able to answer yes or no and have the data to back it up. If you don't measure your goals, you're plodding along a path without any course or direction in your journey. When you measure your progress, you get to see and feel success, make adjustments, and enable yourself to reach your goals more efficiently. Remember, don't limit yourself to goals that are easily measurable. You can set mental goals and measure your progress just as well. Throughout this book, we suggest rating yourself on a scale of 1 to 5 and tracking your progress in a performance journal throughout the season. You can read more about this in parts 2 and 3. Anecdote. We frequently establish mental and emotional statistics for our athletes. For example, after every practice or game, athletes can rate their levels of confidence, motivation, effort, positive attitude, and ability to handle pressure. Athletes who track and monitor their mental progress on a consistent basis simply get better faster. Todd has developed 2 different journals and adapted at times the journals to working with teams and helped coaches and athletes create their own mental stat sheets for after practices and games. In these journals, or individual mental stat sheets, Todd has players rate on a scale of 1 to 5 mental and emotional stats, such as confidence and poise and attitude and effort. He also then creates a small space to jot additional, more specific notes. But each sheet is only 1 page, and when placed in a journal format, easily fits in a player's athletic bag. This is simple and straightforward to complete, and only takes a couple of minutes. But it makes certain that athletes and coaches are reminded to rate themselves on the mental stats in the journal that all athletes need to be aware of, and then many times some specific ones to an individual athlete or team. The athletes who journal get better at a faster rate, and therefore perform better more quickly. This also makes the process more fun, and also allows for you to compete at higher levels if you so desire. giving yourself permission to adjust your goals. Think of your goals as living, breathing organisms. They can change as needed. Occasionally, you'll set a goal and then go out and achieve it sooner than you anticipated. Or you may encounter obstacles, such as injuries or bad weather, that force you to adjust your goals. Successful athletes adjust their goals when they need to, and they don't apologize for it. They realize that they aren't perfect, and that life and the season or off-season can be unpredictable. You need flexibility, not rigidity. Athletes who have rigid muscles do not perform as well, just as athletes with rigid mindsets do not accomplish their goals as quickly or as frequently. Remember, adjusting your goals doesn't mean you've failed. It just means you're changing the course slightly or changing the timeline. Although having to adjust your goals can be frustrating, it's a natural part of success in athletics and life. Realizing that perfection doesn't exist. As you move along the path of achieving your goals that you set out for yourself, it is important to understand that perfection isn't something you should be striving for. After all, it doesn't and won't ever exist. Humans are imperfect beings, and they make mistakes, wrong choices, and fail to achieve their goals on a daily basis. Don't even entertain the idea that you can achieve perfection in your goal-setting program. As stated, you will need to make some adjustments along the way, and that is to be expected. Make sure you allow space for the ups and downs along the path to your ultimate dreams and goals. Allow space for failure, which is part of the process, and allow space for adjustments. Do your best to banish the idea of perfection from your mind, since it is something that you can't achieve anyway. Athletes who accept and even expect failure and mistakes at times are the ones who maintain higher levels of motivation in the long term. How many times do people give up immediately after failing? Thinking about New Year's resolutions. Many people set goals to get in shape and lose weight. Once they go off their diets or miss the gym a couple of times, they give up. They stop going to the gym or start eating sweets and other unhealthy foods. This is part of the reason that gyms are crowded in January and February and then become almost empty by April. People give up because they tried to be too perfect in achieving their goals. Sidestepping common goal-setting mistakes. Goal-setting isn't easy. In fact, we've seen many athletes make the same mistakes when setting goals. Following are some of the most common mistakes. Avoid them when you set your own goals. Setting too many goals. Athletes and coaches tend to set far too many goals, which results in their accomplishing none of them. All the goals you set may be motivating and make sense, but too many at one time confuses the brain and diffuses energy. Instead, pick the goals that are most important or relevant for you and tackle them one at a time. Try to master one goal and then move on to the next one, instead of trying to accomplish four or five things at the same time. Failing to set process goals. Setting outcome goals is fun. You want to win the conference championship, hit a certain batting average, achieve a number of assists or goals, or obtain a college scholarship. Outcome goals go straight to the hearts and excite us. The next challenge is thinking about the process of how you make those goals become a reality. What will you have to do to make sure you give yourself the best chance of reaching those outcomes goals? Most athletes stop short of this, setting process goals because the task feels too overwhelming or too confusing. Just remember that if you don't put your primary focus on your process goals, your desired outcomes won't happen. Leaving your goals in a drawer. Many athletes spend a lot of time before the season setting out both outcome and process goals. Some teams even take a 1 or 2 day team field trip just to focus on the goal-setting process. As the season gets going, however, these goals seem to fade to the background. As athletes and coaches get caught up in the day-to-day grind, they lose focus on their goals and why they want to accomplish them. Goals need to be living, breathing parts of your team mission. You need to tend to them, monitor them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.